Gifts with a purpose are not apt to be regifted if you give something that has a purpose. And the consideration of the gift also is the value, the cost. It's not incumbent upon us to give a gift that is more than we can afford, but what we give should have value. Could I tell you that there are gifts that are handmade items that have become treasures because of what someone put into that in the way of love and creativity. And one of the greatest gifts that all of our family have always treasured was the handmade afghans that didn't cost but several bolts of yarn. But the thoughts and the loves that went into making those have made them family treasures and heirlooms. And so things about gifts that make them truly great are that they are a surprise and that they have a purpose and they have a cost. And so I was thinking about Jesus and his gift, the gift that he was. When the Father gave Jesus, the world had been told for years, the faithful had been told for years, that the Messiah was coming. The salvation from the Lord was coming. They had been told that there would be a servant that was sent from God that would come in his name and his power, that he would break down the chains of oppression and would lead the nation of Israel to freedom. And not only the nation of Israel, but through Israel, the entire world would be blessed by this coming Messiah. And so the faithful looked for him. They would look for him in the streets to see if he would appear. They looked for him even in the skies to see that he would come down from heaven, a deliverer, a mighty man that would perhaps come riding on a white horse with armies riding on horses behind him. They were looking for that first coming. What they were really thinking about was what Jesus is going to be like in his second coming. And the night that Jesus came, it was a total surprise. The Bible says there was in that same country shepherds abiding in their field, keeping watch over their flock at night. And lo, the angel of the Lord appeared unto them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid. But the angel of the Lord said, "Fear not, for I bring unto you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you in the city of David is born this day a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." What a surprise. When they were looking for him to come to the palace, the Father slipped him in the back door. And in a stable in Bethlehem, Jesus came, and it was a great surprise to the shepherds. It was a surprise to the prophet Simeon. Simeon was a man of God that had served the Lord for many, many years and now was of great age, but he had received a promise in his prayer and in his devotion. The Father had spoken to him and said, "Before you die, you are going to see the Lord's Christ. You'll see the Messiah." And so, even though he had reached past the age of retirement when he would serve the Lord in the temple, 50 years old, he had gone past that age many, many years. He still would go in daily to the temple, and he had looked to see. Among the strangers that walked through the doors of worship, would there be that one that he would recognize as being the Messiah? He would look for men of great talent, maybe folks that had followings, people that were miracle workers, people that were great orators and great speakers. And as he watched, one day he saw this humble carpenter and his wife dressed shabbily coming in to the temple to dedicate their 7-day-old baby boy to the Lord. And when he saw him, the Spirit spoke to Simeon's heart, said, that's him. That is the Lord's Christ. What a surprise. He wasn't looking for him in the arms of his mother. He looked for him to be a leader, a powerful speaker, a teacher, a miracle worker. But instead, he saw this baby coming to be presented in the temple to the Lord. And it was a surprise. But I'll tell you, Mary and Joseph were not surprised. They were not surprised because according to the 26th verse, the first chapter of Luke, that as Mary sat by a stream, the angel Gabriel came and appeared to her and told her that she was greatly favored of God, that there was a miracle going to take place, and that she was going to give birth to the child that would bring salvation to his people. Mary said, I can't understand that. I've never known a man. And the angel said, the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you. And this holy thing that will be born of you will be called the child of the blessed. In other words, the Son of God. It was no surprise to Mary as shepherds came around that night of his birth and proclaimed that angels had sent them to the stable to find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. It was no surprise to Mary when the wise men came from the east and brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh and presented them to the mother and to the child, saying that we have seen the King's star and we've come to worship him. It was no surprise to Mary. She kept these things and pondered them in her heart. It was no surprise to Joseph either, because in the early days of Mary's pregnancy, Joseph had already been betrothed with Mary. They had a contract of marriage. Now, in those days, an engagement like that was the same as marriage. That is, you didn't get a collection of engagement rings if you were a young lady going to college and collecting the rings of people that had wanted your fancy and then you changed your mind. When you made the promise to marry, the only thing that would stop that marriage was a divorce. It was that serious. And they had made those first steps of marriage, and they would not come together until actually their wedding had been performed. But while they waited for that day, Mary was found with child. Joseph was concerned, of course he was, and thought, well, I don't want her to be punished, but maybe I should divorce her quietly, so we don't cause any more scandal than is necessary. And while he thought about that, went to sleep, and the angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, fear not, Joseph, to take unto you Mary, your wife, for that holy thing that is born by her is conceived of the Holy Spirit, and you will call his name Jesus. Jesus, which means salvation, is from the Lord. You will call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. What a surprise it was when Jesus came on that first Christmas evening. The second thing about a good gift is it needs to have purpose. And so it was that Jesus, all of his life, seemed to be well aware that his life had a purpose. When Simeon saw him and his parents at the temple, he took Jesus up in his arms. The spirit of prophecy came upon him, and he handed Jesus back to his mother and said that the rising and falling of many of Israel will rest upon this child. And then he looked at Mary and said, and a sword shall pierce your soul also. Seeing the grief that she would one time bear when Jesus bore the sins of the world. There was a purpose, and the purpose was, according to Jesus at the age of 12 in the second chapter and the 49th verse of the book of Luke, when he had been missing for a few days and Mary and Joseph found their 12-year-old son in the temple, reasoning with the teachers and the doctors of the law, Mary said, "We didn't know where to find you. We've been worried about you." Jesus said, "Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business?" He was about his Father's business. The 19th chapter of the book of Luke in verse 10, the scripture says that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. You see, he had a purpose. In John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus said, "I have come that they might have life, and they might have it more abundantly." He came to be the abundant giver of life. 1 John tells us that Jesus came that he might destroy the works of the devil. And so in every one of 37 ways that Satan has attacked the human race, Jesus has come to be the deliverer and destroy all the works of the devil. But I find Jesus having a purpose that almost goes beyond human comprehension. Did you know that there are some things that are in life that are so strange that when you tell somebody, you reveal them to someone, it's so much different than what they expect to hear, so much different than what they've heard before, that they always say, "What?" You have to tell them again before they're able to wrap their mind around it. You know, it's so strange. And Jesus, on three occasions, told his disciples that he was going to go to Jerusalem, that he would be arrested there, that he would be beaten, that he would be crucified and hung on a tree, and he would die. And after 3 days, he would raise from the dead. But that was so different than what they expected to hear that they could not hear it. They could not understand it. They could not believe it. 3 times he told them, and they could not even remember it. When this took place, when Jesus was dead and laying in a tomb, there was not one of his disciples of the thousands that had followed him. There was not one that remembered that he said it was going to happen. See, Jesus always had a secret ambition. It first really became revealed before Jesus ever performed his first miracle. First became revealed when he was in the wilderness temptation. And the devil came to him and said to him, "You do not have to go to your destiny. You do not have to pay the price to buy redemption for mankind. You do not have to destroy the works of sin by the sacrifice of your own life. All you have to do is bow down and worship me, and I will give you all of this world and all of its glory. I'll give you all the power, all the world. All you have to do is just bow down on your knees and worship me." And Jesus said, "Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." And from that day forward, Jesus was in a progression. He had other appointments He had other places to be, things to do, but ultimately, he had only one appointment that he had to make and had to be on time, and that was the appointment at Calvary when he would be offered up his sins or his righteousness to cover our sin. He became poor so we could be rich. He became afflicted so that we could be made well. And he died so that we forever could live. This gift had a purpose.
One, two, three.
When I was a boy, I began my first business selling magazines door to door. It paid a very small commission, but it was enough to pay for fishing equipment, which was my passion. The real incentive to sell those magazines was the bonuses that they paid for the total sales over time. My first bonus was a hunting knife with 13 blades. After that, I got a football, two or three basketballs, and a transistor radio. But the greatest gift that I ever earned was a major league quality baseball glove. Now, it was outstanding. As a baseball player, I was never known much as a hitter. It was my fielding that earned my spot on the Little League All-Star team. And the credit for fielding was given to that glove. It received the nickname VAC, and it was legendary. My friends all tried to get me to trade it, but I never would do that. It was my only claim to fame. It was during this time that I learned what giving gifts was all about. For the first time, I had money of my own, and instead of letting my mother and dad buy little tokens for me to give, I decided I wanted to do my own shopping and buy gifts with my own earnings. Giving became my strongest voice in my love language, and it still is today. I looked at the meager savings I had from the previous year and made out my Christmas list. The list included my brother and my sister, the name I had drawn in my Sunday school class, my dad, and of course, my mother. Now, the Sunday school classmate and my sister were the easiest. They got the sweetest story ever told, which was Lifesaver candy in a box that looked like a book. My brother got a paperback book. He had seen a movie and talked about wanting the book, so he was easy too. Now, my dad had big hands. I mean, really big hands. So when I saw a pair of warm winter gloves in an extra large size, the decision was made. That left only one person on my list. Now, I should have shopped for Mother first. She always put us before everything else, but I didn't. I waited until shopping time was short and money was even shorter. I had only $5 left, and when I walked into the dry goods store in Seneca, Missouri to find a present for my mother, I was thinking about what would cost $5 more than I was thinking about what my mother might like or what she might need. So when I asked the clerk to find me a gift for my mother, she took me to the dresses. But when she found out I only had $5, she took me to bolts of material. But I didn't think it would be right to ask my mother to sew her own Christmas presents, so I asked, well, what can I buy for this $5? So she took me to an aisle that had slips hanging from a rack. The $5 wouldn't even buy a slip, so she suggested a half slip. It was just under $5. And for the whole $5, she would wrap it for me. And I was through with my Christmas shopping, and I'm sure that young clerk was glad to be finished with me. When I took the package home and placed it beneath the Christmas tree, I learned my first and most important lessons about gifts. My aunt, who is only a few years older than me, asked what was in the box, and when I told her, her jaw dropped. She said, David, your mother will never wear that half slip. I asked Dad, and he assured me that my aunt was right. The gift was something my mother would never wear. The situation was such that that gift could not be returned, and I had no more savings. But the gift that I had could never do. I needed a gift with purpose. I needed something with value. I needed a miracle. And I was out of time. It was then that I remembered seeing Mom look at a friend's new wallet a few weeks earlier. And she had told how much she liked it and how beautiful it was. I thought of my mother's own billfold. It was old, much smaller than her friend's new one. How I wished I'd thought of that before my money was all spent. At a Benjamin Franklin store, I found just the wallet that I should have bought for my mother. With a few dollars I had laid back for fishing bait and the money I spent on the slip, I could have bought it, but I didn't. I hadn't learned about giving yet. When Christmas Day arrived, we were ready to exchange our gifts. And I have to tell you that keeping secrets is not one of the greatest qualities that's shared in our family. So Everyone knew about most of the presents under the tree, and it was quite a joke that my mother would be getting an unmentionable article of clothing that she would never use. No one even noticed that the gift wrapping on Mom's gift was slightly torn and that the ribbon was missing. When she unwrapped the box that once held that slip, she found that it was replaced with a brown imitation leather wallet, one that she would seldom be seen without for the next 6 or 7 years. It was a surprise. That little wallet had many features that we could not have imagined. Of course, it was a place for pictures that was quickly filled by pictures of her family. And there was a slot for an extra key that kept us from getting locked out of the car more than once. And there was a hidden compartment for money that held $2 that would take our whole family to the Dairy Queen. She loved it. If it was because the color went with so many of her other things, or the design that made it practical, or just because she had come to expect a gift that she couldn't use, she would show that handbag to everyone that would look at it. And she would show it to them over and over again. So how did I pay for it? Well, it turns out that the few dollars that I had left for that fishing trip that could wait till spring, plus what my neighbor boy's dad was willing to pay for VAC, my flawless baseball glove that couldn't miss, was just enough. To this day, my mother never knew what happened to the ball glove or why we had to get another one before the next baseball season. But we give Christmas presents to emulate the gift that God sent us, and we really want to give our best. When the decision was made that Jesus would come to earth, it was not the day of the crucifixion. It was not even the day of Christmas when Jesus was born. The Bible said that Jesus Christ was given before the foundations of the world was laid. God had already determined that to buy you back and to save my soul, He was willing to give the very best that heaven had. And He bankrupted heaven to give us eternity.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storms with his hands? Did you know that your baby boy walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? The deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know your baby Lord would rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb. The sleeping child you're holding is the great I am. The great
I just would ask you a question that you don't have to answer out loud. Just kind of, how many's ever given a Christmas gift? How many ever gave a Christmas gift and later you wished that you had done a little bit more? And I was just thinking, how many times that we have celebrated Christmas, and as God looked on, His Holy Son was sitting there, and he was the only one that wasn't getting presents. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's got a present except Jesus for Christmas. And I just thought, you know, I would like to do better. I'd like to do better about what I've given to Jesus. See, we cannot give him more money. He wouldn't know the difference. He already owns everything. We could not give him something that was more beautiful because heaven is his home. The thing that we can give him is our life. And the more of us, with the less reservation we give, is the more priceless he considers our gift. I want us today to give Jesus everything. I want us to, without reservation, say to the Lord Jesus, my life, my heart, my soul belong